Good morning, everyone. Today I shall be presenting my first seminar on the topic Principles of Topical Preparations under the moderation of Dr. Khanpur. My SR moderator is Dr. Rashi. Topical therapy is the mainstay of treatment of many dermatoses and has many obvious advantages. Skin is the most accessible organ, and topical application is a non-invasive method of application. And high drug concentrations can be achieved in the skin, that is the target organ, without much systemic risk. And side effects, if occur, are mostly only local in nature. Stratum corneum is the principal layer regulating skin barrier function and percutaneous absorption. The structure of the stratum corneum can be compared to a brick and mortar structure, where BRIC referring to the protein-rich corneocytes and lipids as the intercellular mortar. The intercellular lipids exist in a 1:1:1 ratio consisting of cholesterol, free fatty acids and ceramide. There are three potential pathways of transcutaneous absorption, namely being transcellular, intercellular and shunt pathway, that is periappendicular. All the pathways, it is interesting to note, that are passive and there is no active transport transport across the skin. So since as in passive pathways, the substances follow the pathway of least resistance, or the intercellular pathway appears to be the dominant pathway, despite being just 15% of volume of the transcellular pathway and 50 times longer. Under special conditions like occlusion, sonopheresis, and prolonged hydration, there is one more pathway that opens up, where normally under basal conditions, it's discontinuous, non-permeable, lacunar system which corresponds to corneodesmosomal degradation, but under these conditions, it enlarges and forms a permeable lacunar system. Broadly speaking, duct penetration depends on the biophysical chemical properties of the active compound, the vehicular properties, skin condition, and duration of exposure. If we try to understand the physics beneath the dynamics of duct permeation, we can see that Jmax is the maximum potential flux across the stratum corneum and is the measure of inherent permeability of a specific molecule. Here are some of the equations which help us to understand the physics behind duct permeation. If we consider flux or Jmax, we can see that Jmax is dependent on its permeability coefficient and on the solubility of compound in the vehicle. The permeability coefficient and hence Jmax further depends on the compound's diffusibility across the stratum corneum, its partition coefficient between the stratum corneum and the stratum corneum lipids and the vehicle, which would mean how easily can it leave the vehicle and diffuse into the stratum corneum, and is indirectly related to the path length of diffusion. We can further see that the solubility, hence the movement of the compound across the stratum corneum, depends on lipophilicity and is inversely related to molecular weight. When we put together the first three equations, we come to realize two facts, that to maximize Jmax or the movement of the compound across stratum corneum, we must maximize two parameters, that is the solubility of the compound in the vehicle and the partition coefficient. And it is also interesting to note that both these properties are actually conflicting in nature. To make an ideal ideal topical preparation, we need to find a critical balance between these two. And also that the maximum flux of drug is same for any vehicle if it is applied at its saturation concentration, and then it would hence only depend on its solubility in the stratum corneum. To summarize, drug permeability increases with increasing solubility in the vehicle, increasing diffusibility and partition coefficient, increasing solubility in the stratum corneum, and the balance between the two. And it decreases with increasing path length and increasing molecular weight. When we provide a prescription for a topical preparations, we need to mention the drug concentration, the vehicle or the type of preparation, the methods of application, the frequency of application, quantity and site of application, timing, especially with respect to bathing, the duration of treatment and hazards. We shall look at it all of these individually. So what is a vehicle? The definition of a vehicle is that it is all the constituents of the formulation apart from the active pharmaceutical agent. And an ideal vehicle has some properties, like it provides rapid drug delivery, is non-irritant, non-allergic, is cosmetologically acceptable, provides a stable chemical environment to the drug, provides the drug the ideal drug dilution, the ideal the desired texture and thickness, and can house many constituents. The constituents of the vehicle can be heterogeneous, but broadly speaking can be classified into lipids, emulsifiers, humectants, penetration enhancers, preservatives, and solvents. Although there is considerable overlap between these categories, we will try to look at them individually. Lipids have the role of mostly emollients, diluents, and solvents, with emollients being their most important role. And the commonly used lipids in vehicular preparations are vegetable oils, mineral oils, nanolil, fatty acids and alcohol, and waxes. Emulsifiers are large molecules that are strongly polar and non-polar and are used to hold two immiscible emulsion phases together, namely the dispersed phase and the continuous phase. Depending on the hydrophilic lipophilic balance, which is a measure of strength of the emulsifier, higher HLB values are required for an oil and water emulsion. Here are some of the examples of the emulsifiers like polyethylene glycol, alkyl sulfates, among others. Humectants are compounds with high affinity for water, namely hygroscopicity, and they have an emollient effect by drawing water into stratum corneum. But it is interesting to note that in dry atmospheric conditions where the compound itself gets evaporated, they may even lead to an increased water loss. Some of the commonly used humectants are gelatin, propylene glycol, urea. Penetration enhancers work by the two proposed mechanisms, that is, they cause hydration of the stratum corneum and have keratolytic effect, hence increasing duct permeation. Some of the famous penetration enhancers are azones, dimethyl sulfoxide, propylene glycol, salicylic acid, and urea. Liposomes are also considered one type of penetration enhancers, and I shall be dealing with them later. Preservatives are needed more in water-based preparations like lotions, oil and water creams, and gels, and some of the animal and vegetable oils which tend to become rancid with time. The famous preservatives are parabens, chlorokisols, which are used for corticosteroid creams, among others. Solvents provide dispersion or dilution media to various components of the preparation, and there are namely two types of solvents: volatile solvents, which immediately partition from the drug on application on stratum corneum, mostly alcohol-based solvents like ethanol, methanol, and absorption solvents, which get absorbed with the drug itself, like propylene glycol or water. Few of these solvents also have additional emollient properties, and examples have been mentioned. So I would like to again emphasize that agents like propylene glycol can have a very diverse role. That is, propylene glycol is even an emulsifier, a humectant, a preservative. So hence there is considerable overlap between them. What are the factors affecting topical duct delivery? Topical duct delivery depends on the anatomical site, like areas of less skin thickness like scrotum, eyelids, facial skin, and mucosal surfaces have an increased drug absorption. Topical duct delivery also further depends on our vehicular choice, which would further be determined by the condition of the skin. Like on an inflamed skin, we would like bland preparations. On a dry skin, occlusive preparations. It would further depend on the disease state and severity and on the cosmetic acceptability. Hydration opens up the pores pathways and also the available stratum corneum volume for diffusion, hence increasing drug delivery. Increasing temperature alters the intercellular lipid, increasing molecular motion, hence easing drug absorption. Occlusion interestingly increases both hydration and the temperature of the stratum corneum, decreases rub-off and wash-offs, retain a reservoir, hence is able to enhance drug delivery. Can be provided via gloves, film, hydrochloride dressing, wet wraps and bandages. However, occlusion is also associated with rapid onset of adverse effects like folliculitis, miliaria. And for topical steroids, it can cause rapid onset side effects like skin atrophy, HP axis suppression, where HP axis suppression is mostly seen in children more than adults. And for potent steroids, it may be seen at a dose for, like example, clobetasol, at a dose of as low as 50 grams per week. Also, agents like nignocaine can have potential cardiac complications if applied under occlusion. We must also specify well the frequency of topical drug application for optimal effects with least side effects. Drugs like emollients can be used several times a day, but potent agents like corticosteroids and vitamin D analogs should be used with caution. In a study done by William H.C., it was in patients of atopic dermatitis, it was found that conventional agents like clobetasol corticosteroids, twice daily application is only slightly better than once daily application, but with a much more increased risk of systemic side effects caused than drug usage. Also, it is seen that potent agents, especially corticosteroids, they tend to retain their effect on the skin for much longer duration. Hence, once in 2 days or once in 3 days application can be considered as a method of tapering. Topical drug delivery also depends on the quantity of drug application, where total quantity and duration should be specified well for better compliance. Although different studies give very different quantities required for whole body usage, on an average 20 grams for males and 17 grams for females for once daily application to whole body is required. But since measurement, actual measurement of the weight of the application is a cumbersome procedure, some of the rough guides are fingertip unit, which are, if defined, it's the quantity of ointment extruded from a tube with a nozzle of 5 millimeters in diameter extending from the distal crease of the forefinger to the ventral aspect of the fingertip, and weighs roughly 0.5 grams. Also, two fingertip units or 1 gram of ointment would be efficient to cover areas of roughly 4 adult hands. Here is a chart which shows fingertip units required for a single treatment of various regions in children and adults. It is interesting to note that in children, the fingertip unit required is less than the adults. That is because in neonates and infants, they have thin and sensitive fragile skin with a less effective skin barrier function and less cohesion between cells, a higher body surface area to body weight ratio, and decreased metabolic activity, hence increasing skin permeability with a higher risk of toxicity. If topical preparations are classified as per their physical properties, lotion, solutions, paints, and tinctures are liquids, ointments, creams, gels are semi-solid preparations, powders being solid, and preparations like collodions coming in miscellaneous. Looking at each of them individually, ointments are semi-solid vehicles which are semi-solid agents which are mostly petrol atom based and have occlusive and emollient properties. Depending on what they use as emulsifying agents, they can be classified into polyhydric alcohol based or ketosterol alcohol based. Agents which are polyethylene glycol based are more emollient and occlusive in nature, but ketosterol alcohol based preparations are less greasy and are good solvents but easy to wash. As they usually require no water, they need less preservatives. Creams are also semi-solid emulsions and are of two types, water in oil based and oil in water based. So the water in oil based creams usually require less preservatives but are of a moderate occlusive properties, examples being cold creams. The oil and water creams are easily spreadable, easily washable, cooling and soothing in nature, like vanishing cream. Lotions are liquid formulations which have simple suspension of medication in water, alcohol, or other liquids. But liquid tends to evaporate, resulting in cooling, although because of the same nature, they are more drying than ointments. There are some special types of lotions like liniments, which have to be rubbed before use, example, if efficacent oil for sprains. Shake lotions, which have relatively inert powders in liquid and have to be shaked before application, like calamine lotion or zinc oxide lotion. Paste are semi-solid preparations consisting of insoluble, finely dispersed powders, and they are further of two types, fatty pastes and cooling pastes. Fatty pastes are usually oil or paraffin based and are therefore more greasy and occlusive and protective in nature, like the zinc oxide paste. And cooling pastes are non-greasy, easier to remove, and soothing, mostly used for oozy lesions like the titanium oxide paste. Gels are solid preparations and can be kind of considered thickened lotions. They mostly contain high molecular weight polymers like methyl cellulose, but tend to dry on skin when left on. They are preferred for lesions on scalp and on face, as they are more cosmetically acceptable, but since they are water-based, they require preservatives. Powders are mixtures of finely divided drugs or chemicals in a dry form, usually used to absorb moisture, decrease friction, or to deliver some antifungals. Paints and tinctures are liquid preparations which can be either alcohol, aqueous, hydroalcoholic, or alcoholic. Pure alcoholic paints are called tinctures, which are applied by a brush to skin or mucous membrane, which then tends to evaporate, leaving a film to hold on medicaments. Collodions, some authors also consider as a type of paints. They are based on cellulose nitrate in the organic solvent. Some of the commonly used collodions are salicylic acid and lactic acid for warts, and are also used to seal minor cuts and abrasions. Micro sponges are also considered a type of preparations, and I shall be dealing with them later. Liposomes are aqueous phase surrounded by a lipid capsule with variable diameter ranging from nanometers to several microns, and they are used to encapsulate wide variety of active pharmaceuticals and are one of the penetration enhancing agents. Some, they have more role in cosmetology than dermatology. They are mostly used for tretinoin, benzoyl peroxide, and diethanol to reduce skin irritation. Liposomes have also been used for topical preparation of amphotericin B in cutaneous leishmaniasis, pons burn prophylaxis against candida, one case report for cutaneous mucor, recalcitrant candidiasis, and recalcitrant dermatophytosis. Topical rituximab was used in our departmental study as calcium alginate-based liposome in Dr. Pratik's thesis. Suppositories are solid dosages used to deliver medicines to orofacial orofacial mucosa and other mucosas. Aerosols are used to deliver drugs in solutions, suspensions, emulsions, powder, or semi-solids, but are mainly consist of a propellant apart from the formulating drug. Foams are different in the sense that in addition to both of these, they also have a foaming agent or a surfactant. Other topical preparations are shampoos, lacquers, and bioadhesives. Now, methods to increase cutaneous drug delivery. As of now, all the topical preparations have three constraining properties: that they have less molecular weight, that is less than 500 kilodaltons, 500 daltons in size. They are highly lipophilic, and we are not able to deliver much drug amount to the stratum corneum. The challenge is to overcome this stratum-corneum barrier most safely and reversibly, and to be able to deliver large hydrophilic drugs cutaneously. There are namely three methods by which we can optimize cutaneous drug delivery, being chemical, biochemical, and physical. Chemical enhancement techniques can act by two ways, that is by modifying drug-vehicle interactions or by modifying stratum-corneum. We have already touched upon the drug-vehicle interactions. With respect to stratum corneum modification, chemical enhancers may disrupt stratum corneum lipid organization, may extract lipids out of the horny layer, making them more permeable, forming aqueous channels, or opening up dense protein structure of the corneal set. Agents like DMSO tend to act by all the three mechanisms. Coming to physical enhancement techniques, there are quite a few. Microneedling is a minimally invasive method where we use solid or hollow, disposable or non-disposable microneedles of various shapes and geometries to circumvent the stratum corneum barrier through formation of microscopic channels, which you usually reseal in about 2 hours, but under occlusion they can be made patent up to 40 hours also. The microneedling studies have been associated with PDT and also with 5-fluorouracil, as in our department Dr. Pankhadi's thesis. Ablation and microderma ablation also works along the same principles, where it improves transdermal delivery by removing the stratum corneum, and hence drugs can freely diffuse across the viable epidermis. It is used for the transdermal delivery of insulin, vitamin C, 5-fluorouracil, but is not exactly very feasible. Transfollicular route is being studied as a method of drug delivery, particularly for vaccination, but it currently is in experimental stages, where it is seen that if combined with nanoparticles and on topical application of nanoparticles, these nanoparticles tend to accumulate in the hair follicle, the dermatographics, and the gland openings, where in the hair follicle, if around 600 nanometer size particles are used, the particles tend to reach much beyond the infundibulum, much in the vicinity of the antigen-presenting cells, and hence forming the basis of them being possibly used in vaccinations. Here are some of the study headings for where transfollicular delivery has been tried for vaccine design. High-velocity particles or jet injectors are needle-free instruments which use high-pressure steam of liquid medicament to penetrate skin, and they are mostly used for percutaneous administration of vaccines. But other agents like insulins have also been used. In sonopheresis, we aim for transport of drugs into and through the skin during or after the application of ultrasound. And the ultrasound used in these are usually low or medium frequency, because these frequencies have a high cavitational property. In electroporation, we induce transitory structural perturbation in the lipid bilayer using high voltage pulses, and which hence increase the transdermal drug delivery. The efficacy, as since this is an electric method, the efficacy depends on the electric parameters and the biophysical properties of the drug, and is usually well tolerated, but electric side effects like muscle contractions or discomfort can occur. Here are some of the agents which have been tried to been delivered after during or after ectoporosis. It's like vitamin C, among others. In iontophoresis, we apply a low intensity electric current on a biological membrane or tissue such as skin with the help of two electrodes, which then result in facilitated migration of ionized substances towards the electrodes. It has been studied to a decent extent in dermatology, where zinc oxide iontophoresis has been tried for ischemic ulcers, copper sulfate iontophoresis for dermatophytosis, a well-established iontophoresis of tap water and anticholinergic compounds for hyperhidrosis. Lasers can be used for laser-assisted drug delivery, where ablative fractional lasers like CO2 or erbium-YAG lasers are used to produce microscopic ablated channels adjusted as per patients for drug deliveries, including corticosteroids, photosensitizers, or immunotherapy agents. Used in has been tried for skin cancer, psoriasis, and photo damage. Along the same lines, apart from lasers, we can also use radio frequency. Coming to the biochemical enhancement techniques or the novel particles. The novel particles can be broadly classified into four categories: vesicular systems, particulate systems, emulsion systems, and others. Within the vesicular systems, there are four broad categories: liposomes, neosomes, silicon vesicles, and multi-wall delivery systems. So liposomes are vesicular structures with aqueous core surrounded by a hydrophobic lipid membrane, mostly consisting of phospholipids and cholesterols. We've talked about them a little before. There are also some special types of liposomal preparations which are now widely being used in cosmetology, like transferosomes, which are more elastic and hence more efficacious, marinosomes, which are based on natural marine lipids, are hence less irritable and more tolerable, iterasomes and photosomes, which tend to have DNA repair enzymes and have been tried for UV-induced skin damage, ethosomes, which have more phospholipids and hence can reach deeper skin layers, asymmetric oxygen carrier liposomes, and yeast-based liposomes, among others. In a study done in the University Institute of Pharmaceutical Sciences in Punjab University, Chandigarh, they studied adipilene-loaded solid lipid nanoparticles, which is also a type of liposome, for acne treatment. And they found, this was an in vitro study where they used acne animal models for this study. They found that there was less risk of systemic absorption, more drug penetrability, and in liposomal-based adipilene than the conventional preparations. In a similar study where co-delivery of benzyl peroxide and adipilene was studied using modified liposomal gel for improved acne therapy, they concluded that BPO adipilene modified liposomal gel provided effective and safer alternative to the co-delivery of anti-acne drugs, in terms of that it was seen that it caused less skin irritation in the animal models. Here are some of the other uses of liposomes, like they've been used in moisturizing creams, sunscreens, and minoxidil. Neosomes are also very similar to liposomes, but they are non-ionic surfactant-based vesicles. They have been a L'Oreal patent for long. They are more stable, more bioavailable, but are more irritating in nature. Other vesicular systems are silicon vesicles and multi-wall delivery systems. Coming to particulate systems, we can broadly classify them into microparticulates and nanoparticulates and others, mostly on the basis of their size. So microparticulates are solid polymeric particles of size ranging from 0.1 to 1000 micrometers, and they broadly include microcapsules, which are spherical particles which contain a core substance, or microspheres, which are either empty or solid particles. What micronization does to the substance is that micronization avoids incompatibility of the substance, reduces odor of the active, provides protection to the substance from oxidation and moisture. Hence, they are used in sunscreens, depilatory agents, tocopherols, and vitamin A. Microsponges are a type of microparticulates which are a patented porous polymeric microsphere system, which consists of a porous microsphere which entraps a wide range of actives and then releases them on the skin over time slowly in response to stimuli like rubbing or temperature. Depending on the size, it can be classified into microbeads or macrobeads. Some agents like sunscreen for BPO, steroids, antifungals have been used as microsponge preparations. This is a study done in the Vitiligo and Pigmentation Institute of Southern California, where they studied a microsponge formulation of hydroquinone 4% and retinol 0.15% in the treatment of melasma and post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. And although this was not a comparative study, but they for 12 weeks, it was a 12-week open-label study where everybody applied this preparation twice daily for 12 weeks. And they found that the micro-entrapped hydroquinone 4% with retinol was a safe and effective method where all study parameters gave positive results. Coming to nanoparticulates are exactly like microparticulates, just smaller in size, that with size ranging from 0.003 to 1 micrometer. But as they are smaller, they are better occlusive and more hydrating. And some nanoparticles tend to have self-physical sunscreen properties, so used in sunscreens, retinols, and tocopherols. This was a randomized phase 4 clinical trial for tretinoin nanogel 0.25% versus conventional 0.025%. And they've concluded that in the treatment of acne vulgaris of face, tretinoin nanogel formulation appeared to be more effective and better tolerated than conventional gel formulations. Emulsion systems can be further classified into various types. So microemulsions are stable liquid dispersions of water and oil with a very small droplet size, that is droplet size ranging from 10 to 100 nanometers. And since it's extremely small, it usually requires multiple surfactants. And surfactant combination is more effective than the sole surfactant. So they are occlusive, have aesthetic appearance, and are easy to remove from container as well as the drug application site. They are used, tried for carotenoids and for nadifloxacin, among others. Other type of emulsion systems are liquid crystals, multiple emulsions, polyefferons. Nano emulsions are same, just with having a smaller droplet size, and Pickering emulsions. This was also a randomized phase 4 clinical trial, which studied clindamycin 1% nanogel emulsion formulation for the treatment of acne vulgaris as compared to a conventional clindamycin preparation. And they also concluded that in the treatment of acne vulgaris of face, clindamycin nano emulsion gel formulation appeared to be more effective than the conventional gel formulation and was also less well tolerated. Other systems include fluorines. Fluorines are molecules that are composed entirely of carbon and resemble a hollow sphere. Once a fluorine molecule comes in contact with the skin, it migrates intercellularly and can be used to trap active compounds and then release them into the epidermis. By themselves, they are also very potent antioxidants. Therefore, dermatologically, they have a role in photodynamic therapy, but they have been explored extensively as in cosmetology. Here are some of the uses of fluorines, which are mostly used in hair and makeup products and deodorants and other types of cosmetics. The other novel particles which are still under investigation include the cyclodextrin complexes, which are glucopyranose units arranged in form of two bands where most of the molecules fit into the internal CD cavity, reducing their individual irritant properties. So they've been tried for vitamin A, vitamin C, and cubosomes, which actually are lipid cubes which are surrounded by a porous polymer. Polymers by themselves are usually acrylic acid polymers, which turn into a gel in the presence of water by trapping water into these microcells. And within this water, we can actually suspend solid particles which were otherwise immiscible. And it results in a stable gel formulation which is easy to use and releases active compounds once applied on skin. So I would like to conclude by saying that topical therapy is the mainstay of treatment of many dermatoses, and stratum corneum is the principal layer regulating percutaneous absorption. The intercellular pathway is the most important route of transepidermal absorption, and diffusion of the drug depends on the physiobiochemical properties of the chemical, the vehicular properties, skin condition, and the duration of exposure. The choice of preparation depends on anatomical site, age, severity, and type of lesions. Drug delivery is affected by various factors and can be enhanced using various physical, chemical, and biochemical agents. And a number of upcoming molecules are still under research for establishing their use in dermatology. Thank you. Here are some of the agents with nanoparticles or micronized preparations which are available in India. Thank you.
well-presented seminar, Dr. Vaishnavi. I have a few more points to add. As mentioned, the skin acts as a protective biological barrier, and stratum corneum is a rate-limiting barrier preventing the dermal drug penetration. So there have been use of various penetration enhancers as mentioned below. So what should be the characteristic of an ideal permeation enhancer? The material should be biocompatible. It should not exhibit any adverse pharmacological activity inside the body. That means it should be inert. It should possess a good solvent properties. It should be colorless and odorless. And the course of action should be reproducible, sustainable, rapid, and it should be reversible and should reverse the barrier function of the skin. So the biochemical enhancers, they work by two strategies. Strategy one being the administration of a prodrug in the form of prodrug with an enzyme converter. When it gets penetrated into the skin, it gets converted into the active form after absorption. The strategy two is the co-administration of skin metabolism inhibitors. So we use synthesis inhibitors which temporarily block the synthesis of ceramides, fatty acids and cholesterols for better penetration enhancers. There have also been other novel gel-based preparations like organogels, which are useful for delivery of lipophilic drugs. One example being that topical nifedipine has been used in the form of an organogels in the name of Nifecaine organogels. And current RCT is undergoing where a topical nifedipine 10% cream has been compared with a topical 5% sildenafil for the treatment of secondary Raynaud's phenomena. The results are awaited. Similarly, there are other novel gel-based preparations like hydrogels, example Neutrogena cream, and emulgels, which are a combination of emulsions and gels, which have successfully been used, which are, for example, benzoyl peroxide gel. Thank you. Open for questions. First question from Dr. Somesh, can we apply an active ointment and then cover it with a barrier cream or an emollient instead of achieving it with a physical occlusion?
Sir, actually occlusion acts by the principle that the thing that we are using it for occlusion should hold the agent in place. So it is more practical to do it with physical methods, but I guess if we do it with other things, it should work to an extent. I didn't come across studies where they used other methods of occlusion. So ointments by itself has self-occlusive properties, but I'll have to check.
Okay, and what's the role of lecithin? So there are lecithin, based nano emulsion which are being used for topical drug delivery preparations, and similar to other nano based gel preparations, lecithin has also been used in the combination.
Lecithin, sir, what I read was used as a component in the liposomal, as a component of the liposomes, and hence in nanoparticulate liposomal preparations, and also is a enhancer, is also a biochemical enhancer in one way. Yes, sir. So many particles in topical preparations actually have overlapping roles.
Dr. Kanika has asked, Synod oral paste which we use is what kind of paste?
Ma'am, that I'll have to check and get back.
It is
time synolone. So it is a time synolone, but whether it's actually a paste or not, because paste by definition are solid particles that are suspended in another vehicle. Sir, Dr. Khanpur is saying that synodoral paste is actually an ointment with a ora base which increases the adhesiveness and hence increases top absorption.
And, please highlight cream rinse also, and also highlight shampoos and face wash and serums as drug delivery agents. Are they effective or not?
Cream rinse.
Shampoos, face wash, serums as drug delivery agents. And also highlight cream rinse.
Sir, any since all the absorption across the skin is actually passive, so any type of formulation, if it fulfills the criteria of a small molecular weight and having lipophilic properties, can cause in topical drug absorption if applied for a sufficient duration of time on skin. So even, and I shall include them later, sir.
Dr. Kanika has asked, jet injectors can be used for transcutaneous administration of steroids as an alternative to intralesion steroids, especially in periangual areas.
Yes.
It would be good to provide certain examples with brand names for each type of preparation side by side, would help beginners to relate better.
So for this, if I answer, derma jet was being used not only for steroids, but even for keloids.
Yes, sir. Sir, ma'am, Dermajet is a type of of topical drug injector, high velocity injector, where it used to deliver drugs in a umbrella like fashion, but has gone into dispute because with related to efficacy, so it's no longer used.
What's the price difference of nanoparticle gels in acne? Mm.
Sir, I tried to include, when I tried to find I tried to find the nanoparticle preparations which are available in India, and I could not find much price difference between the conventional acne creams, hence I've also mentioned the prices along. There is not much difference, but the difference is that only a few companies like Cadila and Johnson & Johnson are actually making them as of now, but price-wise there is not much difference.
Also, retinoic acid is available as 0.1% microsphere formulation apart from the 0.04 preparation as mentioned.
Yes,
Dr.
sir.
Nina has asked.
Sir, this retinoic micro is actually available in much in a few more concentrations, but I included this one particularly because it's easily available in India.
One more question. How common is the allergic contact dermatitis to lanolin and paraben? How safe it is to prescribe products containing these?
So both lanolin and paraben are known contact dermatitis inducing agents, and it is much more in the risk is much more with lanolin than parabens. So for lanolins, they have actually stopped using the sheep wool derived lanolin now, and they have shifted to artificially made lanolin derivatives. And similarly for parabens, they now say that the newer parabens have less risk of contact allergy than the conventional parabens. But all of them, yes, have a potential risk of developing allergies.
Is there any difference between foam and aerosol?
Yes, ma'am. I already mentioned the difference between foam and aerosol is that in an aerosol, we do not have the foaming agent which is present in foams. So, that is the only difference between.
Don't worry, we have enough time.
Yes. So, in an aerosol, we have a drug, we have a formulating drug in a solution within a propellant, which is mostly a nonpolar hydrocarbon, which then dispenses it as a thin layer with minimum waste. But it, unlike foam, it doesn't have a foaming agent or a surfactant. That is the difference, sir. So foam is actually much more easier to apply than an aerosol, and is preferred for hair-bearing areas, and usually is seen to have more high patient satisfaction. But the disadvantages with foam is that these foaming agents, which usually act as surfactants, are also potentially ecologically damaging. Hence, some concern is being raised regarding foam.
Should a patient be asked to wet the skin before applying moisturizers?
No, sir. So the moisturizing agents that we usually use, depending on how much potent moisturizing agents do we require, have sufficient on their own. You do not want to ask patients to apply water before.
But
sir, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So it's better than a hydrated skin.
But it doesn't necessarily have to be a wet skin.
Like it's
preferred.
I don't think so, sir. I didn't read, but I'll have to check and get back, sir.
Is there any effect of timing, morning or night application of corticosteroids tacrolimus?
Sir, the obvious advantage with applying them at night is that there'll be less active removal of the application while doing daily works of daily activities, or because the patient won't exert, so won't sweat, and the application won't wash off. Other than that, so it's preferred to ask them to apply them at night. But otherwise, if the patient maintains all precautions, they are of the same efficacy.
Any active agent, can its penetration be enhanced by using a moisturizer beforehand?
Yes, that actually can happen. If we apply a moisturizer before, so on a well hydrated moisturized skin, the topical absorption is more. So active application after moisturizer application can increase duct penetration.
Dr. Khaitan has mentioned gels have a unique quality that they liquefy once coming in contact with the skin temperature. Dr. Ram has mentioned, can you provide any real life examples where we choose one profession over another in the same disease?
Sir, like for corticosteroids, we see that the same corticosteroids in an ointment form would be more efficacious than the cream form. So with increasing severity, say in psoriasis, we shift to the ointment preparations than the cream preparations.
Spray formulations for truncal acne, what is their effectiveness compared to ointments?
So this specific thing, I don't know, I'll have to check and get back. Yes, sir. Sir, the preparation choice also depends on the site. Like for hair bearing areas, we tend to prefer lotions and shampoos and other preparations. And for drier, scalier site, we prefer ointments over other preparations so that they are more moisturizing and occlusive.
Is Orabez itself a gel preparation?
So specifically for Sinotoral and the Aura base, I hadn't actively checked into it. I will have to check and get back.
Non-contact preparations like foam or spray may become more popular if not applied by itself in post-COVID era.
That is an interesting point.
Jet injectors have disadvantage of backsplash and issues related to disinfection of the instrument.
Yes, but that was also the main reason they were actually invented. They were invented as a method of mass vaccination where multiple needles had to be used before. So they thought of a method where if they can vaccinate using jet injectors, but they didn't exactly work out that way.
Any difference between cold cream and vanishing cream? And sometimes we dilute topical preparation with cold cream or Vaseline apart from vehicle oil-based water, water-based oil emulsions. Any other characteristics in context to dilutant which it needs to be kept in mind?
Sir, cold cream is actually a water and oil cream, and vanishing cream is an oil and water cream. So a cold cream would have more lipid component. It would have more emollient properties and would hold the medication we are mixing it with in place more than the oil and water cream. So vanishing cream is an oil and water cream, hence has more water, is easily spreadable, but also on the other hand is easily washable and would evaporate, and the water content would evaporate with time. But it can be used on an irritant skin because it has more cooling and soothing properties.
Dr. Khaitan has mentioned in hot climate like large parts of India, shelf life in room temperature is also an important consideration in choosing a preparation.
Yes, sir. So that is why for oil-based preparations mostly have a longer shelf life because they do not contain water, and by themselves also they require less preservatives. And water-based creams can have more shelf life if more preservatives are added, but the preservatives come at their own cost and they can cause allergy or irritant reactions.
Regarding the question of emollients use and steroid use, Dr. Vishal has mentioned that it's usually advised to give a gap of about 15 to 20 minutes between the use of moisturizer and topical corticosteroids. Dr. Nina has mentioned many studies have shown that hydration does enhance efficacy of topical corticosteroids and moisturizers. Also, lotion preparations can be used on scalp and psoriasis. Creams on thinner skin areas and thin plaques, and ointments on thicker and drier plaques. Dr. Kanika.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Prashant has mentioned Selectin. What paint? Is it a paint or a colloidal?
It's a colloidal.
Dr. Kanika has asked, please highlight nail preparations like nail lacquer.
Yes. The Selectin is actually a colloidal, which is used for warts, because the base substance is actually cellulose nitrate in an organic solvent in Selectin. Some of the nail preparations like lacquers are actually clear or colored varnishes, where the solvent evaporates in some time, but it leaves the topical formulation in a thin film, and which also tends to stays on the nail for a longer time, like Loceryl, which is amlorphin 5%, which is used for dermatophytosis.
Sometimes we prescribe a lot of topical medications. Patients with melasma prescribe sunscreens thrice daily and creams like kojic acid twice daily. Is there minimum gap between the different topical medications?
When we advise treatment for melasma, we usually give Kojivit at night and sunscreens in the morning whenever they're going out in sun or every 3 hourly intervals. So there is an interval between these drug preparations even when we are not actively mentioning them, but specifically how much difference is required between application of sunscreen and agents like Kojivit, I'll have to check.
Washing the area before each application, that point was raised for the sunscreen also.
Sir,
with
respect to washing area between every sunscreen use, even Dr. Jitendra, when studied and got back, he said that no such indication exists. So we do not need to actively wash an area before another coat of sunscreen application.
Question again, we dilute the topical preparations with cold cream or Vaseline. Apart from vehicle oil based water or water based oil emulsions, any other characteristics in context of the diluent which needs to be kept in mind?
Apart from the water in oil and oil in water difference between cold cream or vanishing cream, I can at this point not think of any other difference. And actually the only purpose of dilution is to decrease the drug concentration. So it can actually be done with any type of preparation.
Dr. Kanika has asked face serums and hair serums. Could you please look at both the things and
yes,
let
sir.
Us know?
Ma'am, I will look and.
Would change of a combination agent like cold cream or a Vaseline or a water based and oil based change the efficacy of the primary product?
Sir, it actually will, because speaking from the physics point of view, so there are a lot of agents that determine, there are a lot of things that determine drug absorption. So if the vehicle alters the soluble, if the additional compound alters its solubility in the vehicle, which would now be the heterogeneous mass of two preparations, or it alters its and it can also potentially alter the partition coefficient. So yes, it has a potential of altering drug permeation.
Is there any value to the marketed products like night creams, foot creams, hand creams, face creams?
So all these preparations are actually only moisturizing creams with no other active agent, so they can be treated as a moisturizer. So some, mostly they are only moisturizing agents, but I'll have to individually check. And Orabase is actually composed of gelatin, pectin, and carboxymethyl cellulose, and not exactly has benzocaine. So because of the methyl cellulose, it has more adherent properties than other preparations. Thank you, everyone.